Hi, so yeah, I'm Alexandre Chambaud. I'm the author of Coursier in particular, and now I'm working at a company called Criteo, which is based in Paris. So yeah, in this talk, I'm going to talk about how we can do Spark stuff with Coursier and Ammonite. So with Coursier right now and with Ammonite, we see that it's a bit in progress, but we'll see that. So first, Coursier, for those of you who don't know what it is, quickly, it's a library to manage dependencies, so dependencies from Maven and Ivy repositories. It comes along with a CLI tool called Coursier, and that CLI tool allows to do a bunch of things. In particular, it can fetch all the jars of dependency. Like the first command here, so the first command here fetches all the jars of CRC generic plus those of all of its transitive dependencies. But it can also launch things. That's what the second command here does. So this command not only downloads all the jars of Ammonite plus those of all of its transitive dependencies, it also finds the main class of Ammonite in M. And starts that main class. So overall, that command downloads and starts Ammonite. So and one of the main points of Coursier is that it can download things in parallel, and it does that in a pretty, I mean, in a particular way. So what it does, I mean, in Coursier, it clearly separates two concerns. First, working the dependency graph. On the one hand, and downloading and caching things on the other. And by just using the right type class at the junction of these two things, so Coursier used to use Scalazi, so here we have the non-determinism type class. By just using that type class at the junction here, we get parallel downloads for free. So yeah, parallel downloads are just a matter of using the right type class in Coursier. And so why would we want to use Coursier to handle Spark stuff? To understand that, let's have a look at what happens when we develop and start a Spark job. So very roughly, when we want to do that, we have to grab a Spark distribution that is it's usually a big tar archive. Today, I think it's something like 200 megabytes in size, which contains, among others, all the jars of Spark. And also, we have to put our job in what we call an assembly jar here. So basically, what this is this takes the classes of our job, and this puts that in a jar along with all our transitive dependencies, except the jar of Sparks, but it's little. So basically, so when we handle Spark jobs, we have to manage and handle jars all along. And so once all of that is wired correctly, we can, for example, generate an assembly with a command like this one and pass the resulting assembly to the Spark submit script, which comes from the Spark distribution. And that basically starts our job on whatever cluster we have at our disposition. So that was to run one job manually. It starts to be a bit painful when we have to manage many jobs. In particular, if we have many jobs, we have as many assemblies to handle, and this assembly tends to be quite big in practice. Like they can often reach the 100 megabyte in size, and so we have lots of 100 megabyte files to generate and to move around to start our jobs. And for example, this can take times to generate locally on our machine, but also on the CI. And one question that arises is where should we keep these jar files? Like we can push them to a Nexus server, but it's not that practical at the end. I mean, Nexus servers aren't made to handle, I mean, lots of 100 megabyte files this way. Also, if we work on the system that is supposed to launch Spark jobs this way, we may have to manage Spark distributions. Like, you know, if you're dealing with Spark jobs written by several people, you may not want to bump the Spark version for all of them, for all of those jobs. And so at the end, you have to manage several Spark distributions. And so you have to, I mean, if you want to do it well, you have to automate that a bit. And so you have to write ad hoc scripts to manage that. But at the end, so what we do here is we just manage and handle jars. And this is precisely what Coursier is good at, that is downloading jars and I mean moving them around. So I was working on, I mean, I was running into this kind of issues like a year and a half ago at the company I was working at the time. And so we decided to do things a bit differently using Coursier. And so basically what we did, what we did is we added a Spark submit command to the Coursier launcher. And what, I mean, with this command, we can submit Spark jobs a bit differently. So basically, when we use that command to manage Spark jobs, we forget about Spark distributions, about assemblies. What we do is we simply publish our job with a command like this one. So we generate, you know, standard jars, thin jars, and we push them to an Next server. And then once it's published on a repository, we can just ask the Coursier Spark submit command to submit that job. And so I mean we can do that with a command like this. So we pass Spark submit the coordinates of our job, then we can pass it a bunch of Spark options if we like. And what goes on here is when you start that command, what Coursier does is it looks at these coordinates and it fetches all the jars of our job, all standard jars, you know, and in those it finds the version of Spark that we use, and then it decides to download the jars of Spark for that particular version, and having those jars, it can find the class of Spark Summit in them, and start Spark Summit, passing it the options, the Spark options here, plus all the jars of the job that Coursier downloaded. And so overall, that allows to submit Spark jobs and manage them, handle them, with no Spark distribution at all, with no assemblies at all. It's all standard jars, all the way down. And all the jars are downloaded and cached by Coursier itself. And so they can be downloaded in parallel, they're all cached in the Coursier cache. For snapshots, there are time to live. It's stuff that is not specific to Spark. There are still a few limitations. So in particular, that command has only been used on Yarn clusters. So these are quite standard for Spark, but I'm not sure it's going to work as is on standard clusters or on Spark and Kubernetes. It's just a matter of tweaking things a bit, but out of the box, for now, it doesn't work this way. Also, it's only a CLI tool for now. So it has no clean API. So if you want to integrate that to another tool, scheduling, I don't know, scheduling jobs, scheduling whatever we want, we have to either call Coursier Spark Summit in a separate process, or we have to deal with to do weird things with class orders to launch it this way. And the nice thing is, if ever you run into this kind of ad, you know, the video ads inside news articles, like there are this kind of thing in the Guardian's website or New York Times website. You know, it's the ads with the blue ribbon here from this company. The machine learning stuff that shows this ad for you are handled by Coursier Spark Summit. So I don't work at that company anymore. I left a year ago, but it's still what is used to handle these jobs. Quickly then, so that was to manage Spark jobs. And so we see that we don't have to deal with assemblies, with Spark distributions, and we can use the same kind of things to get a Spark shell. So in particular, so for those of you who don't know Ammonite, it's a friendlier Scala wrapper. It's written by Liao Yi, and it has lots of nice features like pre-printing. It can script things, can add dependencies on the fly, lots of things. And but for now, it doesn't have a working Spark support. But the thing is, we can add Spark support to it with the same kind of tricks we saw just before. So so there are a few things that are missing in Ammonite to have Spark work correctly. So the first one here is actually has been merged recently, so it's internal stuff. But have to see with the way the wrapper works to have it work fine with Java serialization, which is something Spark relies quite a lot on. A few things are still missing, like we will need some glue code to pass things from Ammonite to Spark, like info about the class path of Ammonite to Spark, and also that we'll need a few tweaking in the way Ammonite handles class path. Basically, I'm going to quickly show you unpublished things. I mean, and all of this was tested with a fork of Ammonite called Ammonium, which is, I mean, it quite lags behind the Ammonite mainline for now. And all of things that are here are going to go into Ammonite mainline soon. But basically, what the Spark support in Ammonite should look like once these have been tackled. Should be something like this. So this is internal stuff that rely on bits of Ammonium for now. But basically, the kind of things we can do, we can achieve is starting from a standard Ammonite session, we can add a Spark SQL dependency like this, for example, add a few imports. And start to create a Spark session. And so what goes on here is the user adds Spark SQL automatically. That adds some glue library that provides this REPL Spark session. And when the user actually creates a REPL Spark session, what goes on is this sees that the master is Yarn client, so this adds Spark Yarn to the class path. It does a bunch of other things to have that work. Overall, this doesn't rely on Spark distribution, and this downloads the right version of Spark automatically, like the Coursier Spark Summit command does before. Overall, I think this provides a quite nice user experience for Spark. I mean, we don't have to generate assemblies, we don't have to manage Spark distributions. All of this is handled automatically by Coursier Spark Summit or Ammonite. The two things I show you should need you. I mean, in particular, the Coursier Spark Summit command should soon have its own repository. That way, it will have a proper documentation. It should have more tests. And if you want to, I don't know, I mean, if the kind of stuff it does is interesting to you, don't hesitate to chip in to try it. The last pairs to have Spark support in Ammonite should arrive soon. And here too, don't hesitate to give it a try, to give your opinion, to contribute. So that's it. If you have any question. Yeah, I mean, if we have time, yeah.
What is the question? No, sorry.
Yeah, cool. Thanks.